Good evening and welcome to Poland Daily. I'm Nicholas Richardson and this is the news. Three uniformed and armed men crossed the Polish-Belarusian border during the night. A Polish patrol attempted to stop them. This incident at the border could have serious consequences. Both the Secretary General of NATO and a spokesman for the European Commission have spoken out, and the Polish Ministry of Foreign Affairs has summoned the Chargé d'Affaires of the Republic of Belarus to deliver a protest.
Deputy Foreign Minister Piotr Wawrzyk handed over a diplomatic note to the Chargé d'Affaires of Belarus, Alexander Cheshnovsky, which contained a protest against the increasing provocations by Minsk. These actions are of an increasingly escalating nature. We have communicated that the point of no return is closer and closer due to actions of the Belarusian authorities. I have conveyed that we will not tolerate such actions and we will resolutely, with all means, defend the territorial integrity of the Polish state. According to General Roman Polko, Belarus is using such incidents to test the reaction of Polish border services. What was their purpose? The fact that they had weapons, uniforms, that's one thing. They had no identification marks, which is a violation of all international rules. They should have been detained and treated as bandits. One can presume that it was about finding holes in the border protection system. Meanwhile, on Tuesday, President Andrzej Duda signed a law on the construction of a security barrier at the border with Belarus. The barrier will consist of construction facilities together with installations and electronic or telecommunications infrastructure. Its main purpose will be to prevent illegal migration. We are aware of the challenges that Poland is facing due to the migration crisis created and controlled by the Łukaszenko regime. The president's signature is a landmark decision of a formal nature, which will help to protect the border. Polish government spokesman Piotr Müller said that the construction of the border wall would commence this year and take several months because the area was problematic and would have to be properly secured. It should actually start in a few weeks, he said. Müller added that, according to the plan, construction must be completed in the first half of next year. We would like it to be at the turn of the first and second quarter, especially this essential part, he said, adding that weather conditions could influence construction. Interior Minister Mariusz Kamiński said last Thursday the barrier was planned to be completed in the first half of 2022, that Poland can afford it, and that the appropriate funds had already been secured. According to Polish officials, the border wall is needed due to increased migratory pressure from Belarus, which the government blames on the policies of the Alexander Łukaszenko regime aimed at destabilizing the European Union. The actions of Alexander Łukaszenko's regime are not limited to the escalation of the conflict on the Polish border.
Belsat, a Warsaw-based satellite channel that provides Belarusians with an alternative to Belarusian state media, has been in the government's crosshairs and two of its journalists were jailed in February for filming a protest. Its content was declared extremist in an earlier move in July, meaning anyone caught disseminating it risks being detained for 30 days. The channel is banned in Belarus, though viewers access it on the internet via virtual private networks.
Belsat, a Warsaw-based satellite channel that provides Belarusians with an alternative to Belarusian state media, has been in the government's crosshairs and two of its journalists were jailed in February for filming a protest. Its content was declared extremist in an earlier move in July, meaning anyone caught disseminating it risks being detained for 30 days. The channel is banned in Belarus, though viewers access it on the internet via virtual private networks. Groups of citizens united through the internet resources Belsat are recognized as an extremist formation and their activities are prohibited on the territory of the Republic of Belarus, the Interior Minister said in a statement. Belsat's deputy director, Aleksej Dzikawicki, called the move absurd and a vain attempt to stifle the flow of free and uncensored information. This formulation is absurd. It is the same as punishing people for gathering in the library around a shelf of books with a certain name, the name of a certain type of literature. Of course, to identify millions of Belarusians to be extremists that watch news, that are in social networks, can't be done. Then the whole people are extremists, because after all, the majority of Belarusians trust independent media resources and also Belsat. The move follows a similar clampdown last week on three Poland-based social media channels with a large following inside Belarus. Tens of thousands of people have been detained since the crackdown began last year, and rights groups say that more than 800 people are now in jail as political prisoners. The crackdown prompted the United States, the European Union and the United Kingdom to impose new sanctions on Minsk. But Łukaszenko has remained in power, buttressed by money and diplomatic support from traditional ally Russia. The Belarusian government never loved Belsat. Since 2014, we haven't been granted press accreditation. We were the first ones in this sad list of those that were detained, arrested, and whose equipment was confiscated. Since summer, the situation has changed dramatically. The government tries to find any possible way to clean up the field of information. They, in vain, hope to rip Belarusians off free information without censorship. So far, we are analyzing what this could mean for Belsat. But whatever this could mean, to me it is clear that the authors of this process are getting lost in all of this, and there will be no possibility for them to bring their plans into action. And whatever this is, this will not stop Belsat. We will continue to work.
The Monetary Policy Council has raised interest rates by 75 basis points to 1.25%. This will translate into higher interest rates on loans and deposits. National Bank of Poland President Adam Glapiński also commented on the problem of rising inflation, which is rising well above the assumed ceiling.
An increase in interest rates does not reduce inflation. This is a misunderstanding repeated by the media. We have no influence on current inflation. We may have an impact on inflation a few quarters away from now. From the beginning of next year, we expect inflation to be at its highest. But in particular, immediately afterwards, and we are acting in advance here. Neither the Monetary Policy Council nor the Polish government has any influence on the price of oil, petrol, electricity prices in Europe, or the price of natural gas. This is the great unknown. We expect falls next year. Next year we expect rapid economic growth in Poland close to 5%, but unfortunately also higher inflation. Glapiński said inflation will peak at 7% or perhaps a bit higher in January 2022. He also said that when embarking upon fiscal stimulation programs, central banks and governments had been aware that the increased inflation will be the outcome when emerging from the crisis. The central bank governor added that inflation is higher in countries that avoided a deeper recession and have been growing more quickly. According to Glapiński, Poland emerged from the pandemic crisis with the smallest losses and therefore now has to suffer from high inflation. He also praised his banks and the government's actions during the crisis, which according to him helped Poland avoid an economic disaster comparable to the Great Depression of the 1930s.
The Ministry of Health has announced that 10,000 new cases of COVID-19 were reported yesterday. More than 700 patients were sent to hospital throughout Poland. This is a sign that the fourth wave of the pandemic is accelerating. It is expected to peak in late November and early December.
There are 8,000 people infected with COVID-19 in hospital, almost 700 of whom are connected to a ventilator. Most of them are unvaccinated and relatively young. They often have to use ECMO therapy, which is a last resort for respiratory failure. These are very young people, 29 or 31 years old. The highest number of infections is in the Mazowiecki Voivodeship. However, as experts point out, if one compares the number of patients as a proportion of the number of inhabitants, two provinces are leading, Lubelskie and Podlaskie. In the eastern part of Poland, there are still fewer people willing to be vaccinated than in the rest of the country. The epidemic is not spreading evenly in Poland. There are provinces that are more exposed. For several weeks now, we have seen that the infections are concentrated in the east of the country. Because of the increasing number of patients in hospital, temporary hospitals are reopening. A hospital in Warsaw's Okęcie Airport will be opened this Friday, and there are also plans to reopen a hospital in the National Stadium. But the exact date is not yet known. We have called for the deployment of such hospitals to begin with, so-called key military hospitals. There are 8 such hospitals in Poland, more or less evenly distributed. As a second step, we propose the establishment of further facilities if the organizational capacity of the local health service allowed it.
That's the news. Thank you for watching. Stay with us for the weather, Poland Daily Business, and more programs. But from me, it's have a good night and a better tomorrow.